Very good morning, dear students. Welcome back. This video is for class 10th science, chapter number 12, electricity, and this is lecture number 3. In today's lecture, we are going to study about the factors on which the resistance of a conductor depends. As in our previous lecture, that is lecture number 2, we have studied about circuit diagram and Ohm's law. We have done various symbols for electrical components which we use in the circuit diagrams. And we have also done Ohm's law. According to Ohm's law, potential difference across the ends of the conductor is directly proportional to the current flowing in the circuit. When we remove the proportionality constant, we get a constant which is called resistance. This resistance is the property of a material because of which a material offers the resistance or it opposes the flow of charge. It can be variable or it can be fixed. And depending upon the amount of resistance offered by the material, we have seen the varieties of materials like good conductors, bad conductors, or you can say the or we have insulators also. Let us start discussing on the factors on which the resistance depends. So, generally, the resistance of an object is there. So, for example, we are using a conducting wire. So, that will provide the resistance to us. And if we have to see the effect of length on the resistance of conductor. So, here, in front of you, I have a circuit. So, as you have studied about the symbols which we use in circuit diagrams, so here our circuit diagram, here this is our battery and this is the key or the switch, but now this key is open. This is our ammeter which will measure the current in the circuit and this is our resistance or specially the wire which on which we have to see the effect of the length of conductor. So suppose at the first situation, AB, that is the length of the conductor is L. And we have to see the effect of length on the conductor. Then the first thing that we have to do is that first we have to measure, we have to close the key once. And what we have to do? First we have to see that what is the current flowing in the circuit when AB length of the conductor is attached or joined in the circuit diagram. So suppose that value comes out to be x ampere. I'm not giving it a value because it's not an experiment which we are doing. So this is just a theory based class. Although we should perform an activity on the basis of that, but hopefully we'll be doing this when we are in the school. Then what we have to do? We have to change the length of the conductor. So let us double the length. So now AB is 2L. So what will happen? That I'm telling you that what will happen. When we take a length 2L, then the current which was x ampere earlier, now it will decrease by half. It will decrease by the value half. So what is happening here? When we were having the length L, then x ampere current was flowing. When we are having 2L length, then half of the current is flowing. And according to Ohm's law, what we have? V is equal to IR. Potential is same as the battery is providing us a fixed voltage. And we have to see that what is the effect on R. If we are getting, earlier we were having x ampere, we were having R resistance and this was V. But the newer equation which is of when we have changed the length of the conductor as 2L, then what will happen? This current has reduced to half and this R is still this. We don't know, so let us put it as R dash. So by increasing the length, the effect has come on this. and now this overall value has decreased. That means because potential is the product of current and the resistance, so there must be some variations in the resistance as well, because we have increased the resistance, the length of the conductor now. So overall this value has decreased, but what has been increased? The resistance. And by how much factor? 2. So when we are doing the length double, the resistance also gets doubled. That means resistance is directly proportional to the length of the conductor. When length of the conductor increases, resistance will also increase, and vice versa. The second factor is area of cross-section of the conductor. That means how much is the cross-sectional area, that will also affect the resistance of the material. So earlier we have doubled the length. Now let us take the length AB only, and that is L. But we are taking two wires. One is having length AB and cross-sectional area as A. Another wire of same length, but cross-sectional area is 2A now. Then what will happen to the resistance of the conductor with the same diagram that we are having? A battery, a key, ammeter and the conductor. So this is our ammeter and this is our closed key and this is our resistor A, B. So in the first case, what is happening? AB of length L is having a cross-sectional area A. X ampere current is flowing in the circuit. Second case is when AB length, that is L, conductor is having the same length, but now the cross-sectional area is doubled, or you can say increased. The current which will flow now is increased. This will happen when we perform the experiment. Why this is happening? Because we know that in a conductor, suppose this is the conductor, and in this electrons, so we have electrons in the conductor which are free, and they are free to move in the material only, because they are bound to the nucleus as well, but the outermost electrons are free to move inside the metal. So when this space is very low, then when the potential is applied across the ends of the conductor, what happens? The electrons which were earlier moving in the random directions, they start moving in a particular direction. This way. They tend to align themselves in a particular direction. They drift towards the positive terminal of the battery. And because of that, the interaction between the electrons, the free electrons, and the atoms, or you can say electrons and electrons, is increased. And because of that, resistance, or you can say the charge is resist or opposed to flow in a particular direction. What happens when we increase the cross-sectional area? Suppose now I'm doing this. I have a cross-sectional area. So this is our new wire which is having the cross-sectional area doubled, or you can see the thickness of the wire is increased. So when the thickness of the wire is increased, now the electrons, although here also will be having electrons, and they will also try to move in a particular direction, and then they will also strike with the atoms or other electrons, but now there is more space available, and hence the resistance decreases, and the electrons, they are easily moving in a particular direction, or they drift towards the positive terminal of the battery. That means we can say that how cross-sectional area is related to the resistance, it is inversely proportional to the cross-sectional area. Resistance is inversely proportional to the area of the conductor, cross-sectional area of the conductor. Let me show you that what is the cross-sectional area actually means. So here, suppose this is your conductor. Although this is a sketch pen, but suppose this one is your conductor. If the current flows through this conductor, then suppose x ampere of current is flowing. What happens if the current flows in from the same length of the conductor, but the cross-sectional area is doubled now? Now what will happen? The current will increase because the resistance is decreased now, because the thickness of the wire is increased. And what is the cross-sectional area? When you cut this pin from in between, then you can assume, or let me show you, this portion is the cross-sectional area through which the electrons flow or the charge flows. So you can see the difference between the cross-sectional area of a thick wire and a thin wire. Now you can understand that why the resistance of thick wire is less and why the resistance of a same length wire but the cross-sectional area with a very less cross-sectional area is high. The resistance is high in the cross-sectional area where the cross-sectional area is less, and the resistance is low where the cross-sectional area is high or large. So this way we can say that resistance is high in case of a thin wire and resistance is low in case of a thick wire of same length. The third factor is nature of the material, that how the resistance is related to the nature of the material from which the conductor is made. So to verify this, we have to do one thing. We will take two different wires, or you can say, let's say one we take copper wire, another is aluminium wire. Although both are conductor, but what is the relation between the resistance and the nature of these two wires? So we have the same circuit diagram in front of you, that we have a battery, we have a key, ammeter and a resistor, conductor. But in first case, we took copper as AB or the conductor, and in the second case, we took aluminium as the conductor. So what happens? Connect the copper wire between the terminals and we have to measure the readings. We have to see the readings in the ammeter. Then the readings will be, the ammeter readings, suppose they are X ampere. And when we use aluminium in the place of copper as a conductor, then the readings are Y ampere. That means, although they are of same length, but still they are having different resistance because the current is different. And according to V is equals to IR, that is Ohm's law, if potential is same and the total product of the current and the resistance is should be same. That means when the current is increasing, the resistance must be decreasing to get this overall product as same. And when the current is decreasing, the resistance must be going high so that this product can come same. So in case of copper wire, copper and aluminium, they both are very good conductors of electricity. But it was found that when copper wire was connected as a conductor, the current was more, and the aluminium, when the aluminium wire was used as a conductor, the resistance, or you can say the current, was less. That means resistance of copper is less as compared to the resistance of aluminium wire. The fourth factor is temperature. So in a conductor, as we know that there are free electrons, and these free electrons are responsible for the conduction of charge from one point to another point of the conductor. But what happens when the temperature of the conductor is increased? So when a conductor is connected with a potential difference, or you can say a cell or a battery, and if the potential difference is applied across the ends of the conductor and the electrons which were earlier moving in random directions, they will drift towards the positive terminal of the battery. And in doing this, these electrons, they strike with the atoms or other electrons, and which hinders the movement of the electrons through one end to another end. And when the temperature is increased, the oscillatory motion of electron increases, and because of which the hindrance increases more. So because of that, less charge can flow from one end to another end of the conductor. And that is why it is said that the temperature is directly proportional to the resistance of a conductor. That means whenever temperature is increasing, the resistance of the conductor will also increase. Now, let us summarize all the four factors. That first factor is length. So from that factor, we got to know that length is directly proportional to the resistance, or you can also write it as resistance is directly proportional to length of the conductor. So this is our first equation. Then resistance is inversely proportional to the cross-sectional area of the conductor. That is second factor. Third is that resistance of different materials, or you should say resistivity of different materials, is different. So that is resistivity. And one factor is temperature, but temperature and resistivity, they both are material dependent. So when we combine the first and second equation, what we get? R is directly proportional to the length by area. And when we remove this proportionality constant, then we keep a constant rho here, and this rho is called the specific resistance or the resistivity of the material. The specific resistance or resistivity can be calculated as that we have R is equal to rho L by A. We take rho this side and all other things this side. So cross multiplying it, we get rho is equal to R A by L, where R is the resistance, A is the cross sectional area, and L is the length of the conductor. So we can define resistivity as that resistivity is the resistance offered by the conductor of unit cross-sectional area and unit length. Or you can say that when area of cross-section is 1, length is 1, then rho is equal to R. That means resistivity is that much resistance offered by the conductor when unit length conductor is having a cross-sectional area unit or 1. So in the form of definition, we can write it as resistance of the conductor. This resistivity is the resistance of the conductor of unit length and unit cross-sectional area. To the resistance into cross-sectional area upon length. So resistance is having units ohm, and this symbol is this. Area, if it is in meters, then meter square, and length is in meters. So here you can see the resistivity units comes out to be ohm meter. So ohm meter is the unit of resistivity in SI system. Here in your NCERT book, one table is given at page number 207, table number 12.2. And in this table, different materials have been shown with their resistivity. So you can see that in case of conductors, resistivity is in the powers of 10 raised to power minus 8. So it is very less as compared to the alloys, which are having a range of 10 raised to power minus 6. But the insulators are having a resistivity very high, that is in the range of 10 raised to power 10 to 10 raised to power 14. And that is why, because these materials are having a very high resistivity, they do not conduct electricity at all. That means as we go from metals to alloys and towards the insulators, the resistivity increases. But always remember that resistivity is property of a material and it does not depend on the area of cross section and the length of the conductor. It is independent of the area of cross section and the length of the conductor. Now, as we have seen that different materials, they have different resistivities, then what is the use of having different values of resistivity? So this can be understood by seeing the uses of different materials. So the first is connecting wires. As we use the connecting wires in the circuits, electric circuits, so the conductors like copper, aluminium, these are used as the connecting wires because they have a very less resistivity. Silver, copper, aluminium, these are used, or you can say these are one of the good conductors of electricity, or they are having a very low resistivity. But silver, as we know that this is very costly, although silver is the best conductor of electricity, but because of its cost, it is not used in the case of connecting wires. So we use copper and aluminium for connecting wires. Then we have this filament of bulb. Filament of bulb is made with the tungsten. Tungsten is a metal which is having a very high melting point, that is 3380 degrees Celsius, which is very high. And because of having such a high melting point, tungsten does not burn or oxidize at a very high temperature. The next is that heating elements of electrical appliances like electric iron, electric heater, electric toaster, room heaters, they are all made with the nichrome. Nichrome is an alloy of nickel, iron, chromium and manganese. It is having a very high temperature, which is 1500 degree Celsius. So this very high melting point is having a use that this material, this alloy can be used to make the products such as heating elements of the electrical appliances. We have talked about the metals and the alloys, but the insulators, which are having a very high resistivity, they are also used to protect ourselves from severe shock of electricity, as they are insulators, they do not conduct electricity, so they can be used to protect ourselves from electric shock. The homework for today's lecture is question number 1. On what factors does the resistance of a conductor depends? Question number 2 is, will the current flow more easily through a thick wire or a thin wire of same material when connected to the same source and why? Question number 3 is, why are the coils of electric toaster and electric iron made up of alloys rather than a pure metal? Question number 4 is, let the resistance of an electrical component remains constant while the potential difference across the two ends of the component decreases to half of its former value. What change will occur in the current through it? So this is the homework of today's lecture. Now let us see the homework solutions of lecture number 2. In homework of lecture number 2, we were having 4 questions in total, which were from some other reference book. Question number 1 was, what is the circuit diagram? And the answer to this question is, circuit diagram, a diagram showing the arrangement of various components in an electric circuit with the help of their symbols is called circuit diagram. You can also make one diagram which shows the arrangement of various components, like you can have one switch, battery, a load or a conductor. This is one of the circuit diagram you can make, where we have one load, battery and a switch. Question number 2 is, write and learn the symbols of various electrical components. I hope you have learned by writing the symbols of various electrical components. But let me show you once more that for electric cell, we use the symbol with a one bigger line and one smaller. The bigger line is positive one, positive terminal of the cell, and smaller line is negative terminal of the cell. Then we have a battery, which is combination of two or more cells. Plug key or switch is made with this symbol. Plug key, when it is closed, this is made with this symbol, or it can also be made as this. Then wire joint can be shown as with the help of this symbol. When the wires are crossing without joining, then you have to make the two wires in this way. Electric bulb or load can be made with this symbol. Then we have resistor. So resistor can be shown as with the help of this zigzag line. If the resistance is variable, then it can be shown as this. This is the symbol of rheostat, which is a variable resistance. Then ammeter with this symbol, and voltmeter with this symbol, which is having a positive and negative terminal. So these were all the symbols. You have to learn the symbols of all the electrical components, as they will help to make a circuit diagram and to identify the electrical components which are there in the electric circuit diagrams. Question number 3 is, define 1 ohm resistance. So you can define the resistance as 1 ohm by writing first the Ohm's law equation, which is V is equal to IR. Then find out R, which is the ratio of potential difference to the current. And what is the definition of 1 ohm resistance? That the resistance will set to be 1 ohm if 1 volt potential difference is applied across the ends of the conductor and 1 ampere current flows through the conductor. So that resistance offered will be 1 ohm. Fourth question was that you have to study the activity in the NCERT book at page number 203. And you have to write the conclusions, but as this activity is to be performed in the laboratory, so for now what we have to do, we have to make our assumptions on the basis of another examples in which the potential difference is increased and its effect is seen. So that we can see with the help of voltmeter and ammeter, but as here we don't have ammeter and voltmeter. So what example we can take? We can take the example of fan regulator. When you increase the speed of the fan, then what happens? The potential difference applied across the ends of the conductor, which is going to the fan, is increased. And when this is increased, what happens? The speed of the fan is increased. So this way you can assume, I know this is not the real situation, but what is happening in the activity is that in the activity we have one conductor which is made up of nichrome, which is an alloy, and we are having battery, which is combination of more number of cells. We have ammeter to measure the current of the circuit, and voltmeter to see the potential difference across the ends of this conductor. So you can see here, voltmeter is connected parallel to the resistance, or you can say the conductor, and the ammeter is connected in series with the conductor, as it has to measure the resistance, it has to measure the current through the connection or the path. So here we have a switch. So now the switch is closed, that means the battery is giving or maintaining a potential difference across the ends of the conductor. And what is this activity saying? That we have a table in which we have number of shells which are used in the circuit. The first case we use one cell, then 2, 3 and 4. So what happens in case of current and ampere, that we have to see the readings of voltmeter and ammeter, that what is the relation between the voltage or potential difference and the current. So when we use first only one shell, then there will be some value of current and voltage. When two cells are used, potential difference will also increase, so accordingly current will also increase. And the same happens when we increase the number of shells used. So the ratio of voltage to current, that is resistance, that value will also vary. And we have to draw a graph like this, current and voltage. So by plotting these values, we will get one linear line. And I have told you how to get the value of resistance by using a graph, that you have to take any two points, you have to put the perpendicular on the x-axis and the y-axis. Then you will find the value as y2 minus y1 upon x2 minus x1. So this will give you the value of resistance in this case. So this is what the activity says. I hope you have understood this, and we will also perform this when we are joining the school. So till then, take care and goodbye.